This is my first talk on my book tour, and this couldn't be a better crowd. I've done three talks. This is my third talk here. My first one was for Republican Gomorrah. If you're interested in kind of the origins of the Duggar clan, you should pick it up. With the Republican primary starting, and it's such a freak show. I forgot, that I used to, cover it, and it just makes me love being American because, we're on the front row of the freak show right here, and it's, I know Donald Trump just got fired by NBC, but he's still running for president, so we can be entertained. And and I thought I would come here for some better weather, but it looks like I've never heard people in Seattle complain about a lack of rain before, so I think we have some work to do on climate change. I'm not going to speak to you about a very amusing topic tonight. I'm going to talk to you about my book, The 51-Day War, which I wrote in about 51 days under extreme pressure from a publisher who thought it was important to get this story out. I wrote it after being in Israel-Palestine for over a month during the 51-Day War, about a month, including 2 weeks in the Gaza Strip, which is a very difficult environment to work in, not just for safety reasons, but for so many other logistical reasons. And, of course, it's most difficult for the people who, unlike me, can't leave the walled-off ghetto. I wrote this book to remember those who died during the war, all 2,200 of them, not just those who we think of as civilians. I wrote this book to honor the resistance of those who fought to defend their homes inside the Gaza Strip. And I wrote this book to expose the criminals who destroyed Gaza and who killed over 500 children, mostly killed in their homes, in their bedrooms at night. And I wrote this book to put on the record the true story of the war. When did this war start? How did it begin? Did it begin on July 8th, 2014, as we're told? No. We could all go all the way back to 1947, when the Nakba began in earnest, when 750,000 indigenous Palestinians were forced out of their homes, off their land, and a large percentage were pushed into the Gaza Strip, which is now today a warehouse for the surplus humanity who are not welcome because they are considered a demographic threat, a threat to the ethnic purity of the Jewish state in Israel and the Levant. And so that is really the backdrop to this war, to every war that's been fought in and around Israel-Palestine. Did this war begin in 2005 when Israel began to withdraw its settlers from the Gaza Strip and then promptly laid siege to Gaza after annulling elections in which Hamas was democratically elected? That is another piece of understanding. That is another piece of context that we need to understand. After this disengagement, which was celebrated by liberals in the U.S., we saw war after war using disproportionate force in the Gaza Strip, using 2,000-pound fragmentation bombs against the Gaza Strip, tank shells, 155-millimeter howitzer shells against civilian homes, and a doctrine that Israel called the Dahiya Doctrine, named after a neighborhood it destroyed in South Beirut in the 2006 assault on Lebanon. A doctrine which aims to punish the civilian population in order to turn them against their political leadership. As Gadi Eisenkot, who is now the chief of staff of the Israeli army, said to the Israeli newspaper Yediot Aharonot, "In the future, everyone in South Lebanon is Hassan Nasrallah, and who is the spiritual leader of Hezbollah, and everyone in the Gaza Strip is Khalid Mishaal, who is the head of the Hamas Politburo." In other words, there's no distinction between civilians and political leadership or armed factions. And so that is the open stated doctrine of the Israeli military going into this conflict in the Gaza Strip last summer. And it was a war. It was a war between very, very two very unbalanced, with an extreme power imbalance. And I want to emphasize the backdrop to the war. The war did not begin in the Gaza Strip. It began about 10 kilometers from Hebron at an intersection where three Jewish Israelis in the occupied West Bank were hitchhiking. They were kidnapped by two rogue Hamas operatives, two figures operating without orders from Hamas, on their own, in order, after the collapse of the peace process, in which Israel refused to release a final batch of Palestinian prisoners in order to continue the peace process. Apparently, they were kidnapped in order to spur a prisoner release by other means of some 1,000 Palestinian prisoners. The kidnapping attempt failed immediately when one of the Israeli teens attempted to phone the police, got on the phone with the police. The police had a recording. The police heard gunshots. The police heard celebratory singing from the two killers. And the police, less than 24 hours later, found the burned car with blood, DNA, and bullets inside. What they didn't do, after telling Netanyahu, after bringing the Shin Bet, Israel's General Security Service, into the investigation, was inform the Israeli public. Instead, the Israeli military issued a gag order on all journalists, which forbid journalists from even reporting the existence of a gag order, which prevented them from describing, from detailing the investigation. All Jewish Israelis and the rest of the world knew, including in Jewish communities in the U.S., which were compelled to participate in these solidarity displays for the three missing, supposedly missing teens, was that the teens were missing, that Hamas was responsible, and that they could be anywhere, which led to Operation Brother's Keeper, a massive military invasion of the West Bank, including West Bank cities that had not been invaded since the Second Intifada. Hundreds of Hamas members and leaders, political leadership, were arrested. Palestinian prisoners who had been released under the Gilad Shalit prisoner swap were rearrested. And this was all a pretext for dismantling whatever infrastructure of Hamas and opposition to the Palestinian Authority, which went along with this entire operation and assisted it with its US-trained security services, was remaining. So you have Israeli troops rampaging through the West Bank in the Gaza Strip, where Hamas maintains power. They're looking at this as an act of war, as their leadership is being arrested without charges, on administrative detention, thrown in jail, sometimes tortured. The teens were discovered 2 weeks after they were kidnapped kidnapped on June 12, 2014. They're discovered, and an Israeli public which had thought that they were missing learns that they were dead. They are found in a shallow grave on the property of the suspects, whose families had been interrogated 24 hours after the kidnapping. How did Israel not find these teens who were in a shallow grave on this property with all their advanced satellite systems, all of their monitoring capabilities in the West Bank and their collaborator networks? They were found by volunteer Jewish Israeli hikers. Very confusing. It's almost like a deception was underway. They were found, and the Jewish Israeli public erupted in outrage and anger and in indignation. Netanyahu appears before his cabinet and he declares, "Vengeance for the blood of a small child, even Satan has not yet created." He explicitly calls for blood vengeance for these three teens, quoting from a 1908 poem by the Hebrew poet Chaim Bialik, referring to and describing a pogrom against the Jewish population of Kishinev, in the Pale of Settlement, where my family comes from. So he's telling the Jewish Israeli public that they are victims of a pogrom committed by Palestinians who are no different from the rampaging anti-Semites of Europe. Within less than 24 hours, mobs erupt in Jerusalem, in central Jerusalem, declaring death to Arabs. That was their chant, Mevet le'Aravim. That was the cry that Netanyahu inspired, and he inspired the killing of Mohammed Abu Khader, a 15-year-old Palestinian boy from the occupied neighborhood of Shufat in East Jerusalem, kidnapped by Jewish-Israeli fanatics on his own property, forced to drink gasoline, and burned alive. This was the response. This was a warning to the Israeli government. It was a signal to the Israeli government that you either act or the situation will intensify and grow out of control. So Netanyahu redirects the situation to Gaza after declaring all of Hamas is responsible, when in fact there were no orders from Hamas for this kidnapping. The war that we're going to hear about is said to have begun on July 8th. It actually began on July 7th, so it's a 51-day war, not a 50-day war. It was on July 7th that Netanyahu and his defense minister Moshe Yaalon authorized airstrikes on Hamas positions in Gaza. Seven figures from Hamas's armed wing, the Al-Qassam Brigades, were killed. So after watching Operation Brothers Keeper go down in the West Bank, then after these assassinations, Hamas decides to go to war and authorizes launches of long-range rockets, which carry very little explosive capacity but do psychological damage. My colleague and friend Alison Deger, who was in Shufat the night of July 8th, remembers an M75 rocket sailing overhead from Gaza. As air raid sirens went off, she stood with the cousins of Mohammed Abu Khudair, the boy who was burned alive. One of them held her hand and said, "That rocket's for Mohammed." And that's how it was understood, as an act of resistance and an act of vengeance. And so the war began. Within days, on July 12th, the Israeli forces authorized a ground invasion of the Gaza Strip. Troops rumbled into the neighborhood, the city of Shujaiya, which is a neighborhood east of Gaza City, which lays hard against Israel's border areas. These troops were unprepared for any confrontation. Some of them entered in armored personnel carriers, which were actually 1960s era American Vietnam War relics. What they didn't know was that the Gaza Strip and the Al-Qassam Brigades, the military wing of Hamas, was undergoing a process of military advancement. For years, this faction had been identified with suicide bombing and attacks on Israeli civilians. And that was an example of their weakness, their military weakness. They didn't possess guns. They didn't possess the kind of weaponry that could compete with the Israeli military. And so the choice was to respond by attacking soft targets, Israeli civilians. That strategy changed under the leadership of Mohammed Deif, who is the fifth leader of the Al-Qassam Brigades. All of his predecessors have been assassinated, and he has nearly been killed four times, is severely handicapped from the four assassination attempts. His partner in the militarization process, Ahmed Jabari, was killed in Operation Pillar of Cloud in 2012 in an assassination. What they did was create a network of tunnels underneath the Gaza Strip, largely for defensive purposes, and plan to fight the Israeli military head-on, as Hezbollah did, in South Lebanon. The Israeli military failed to take a signal and failed to understand that the Al-Qassam Brigades could compete with it, even after a frogman team from the Al-Qassam Brigades swam into the ocean, into Israeli territory, stormed into an Israeli military base, and actually laid explosive charges on an Israeli tank. This was at Zikim, which is a kibbutz. They could have easily entered the kibbutz and killed scores of civilians, but they chose to attack military targets. Then, as they attempted to get in back to the sea, they were killed by drones. It was basically a suicide mission. The Israeli military covered up what happened there, and it was only leaked later on. The Israeli military failed to tell the public that it had lost a battle during an initial amphibious assault on the Gaza neighborhood of Sudania, which was repelled by the Al-Qassam Brigades. And so when they entered Shujaiya, the first real battle of the war, these armored personnel carriers came under attack by sapper teams, who often ran up to them and planted explosive charges on the armored vehicles by hand. One was completely destroyed. An Israeli soldier was taken alive after seven or eight were killed, and the Israeli military went berserk. Meanwhile, its soldiers came under attack from snipers. It came under attack from infantry, and just a general sense of panic fell through the ranks of the Israeli military. Back in Tel Aviv, Central Command ordered all troops to retreat into heavily armored modern Israeli armored personnel carriers, pull back, and the entire area of Shejaiya was blanketed with 155 millimeter howitzer shells, 2,000 pound fragmentation bombs, and within some 24 hours, an entire city was completely gone. This was Israel's response to losing a battle. So at this point, and this was ignored, I mean, I really want to emphasize that the Al-Qassam brigades of Hamas was fighting under a different doctrine than the Israeli military. Mohammed Deif and his spokesman, Abu Obeida, went on into international media, was never relayed to the American public, and mocked the Israeli military for attacking civilians and said, "We won't attack civilians. Our fight is with your soldiers," which is why some 75 Israeli soldiers were killed during this conflict. Five Israeli civilians were killed, including one child, Daniel Traegerman. And everyone knows Daniel Traegerman's name, but nobody can name one of the over 500 children in Gaza who were killed. In Shejaiya, during a seven-day ceasefire, I met the Attash family, which was lucky enough to have lived through a night of hell, a massacre which left over 150 people dead. They lived because the 1,000-pound Mark 82 dumb bomb, which was lodged into their ceiling, failed to explode. And the day before I met them, it was disarmed by a bomb disposal expert. I met the family of Salem Shamali the same day in Gaza City. Their home was completely destroyed. Much of their family was killed, including several members in execution-style killings who I met in the ruins of their home. And I met this family because their son, Salem, had gone looking for them, 19-year-old Salem, with a group from the International Solidarity Movement. Salem was wearing a green shirt and jeans, and he wandered into a street where his family lived and called out for them and suddenly fell to the ground. He was shot once, and the International Solidarity Movement volunteers who were with him filmed him. Then he called out again, and he was shot again and crumpled to the ground, and then finally an Israeli sniper finished him off on camera. Many of you saw this killing or heard about it. It was actually reported by my friend Ayman Moaldin from NBC before he was strangely reassigned. I found a map in the rubble of Shejaiya, which is reproduced in my book. It was an Israeli military map that I found in an empty ammunition box. And this map contained markings in Hebrew that I didn't fully understand until I went to Brussels to participate in the Russell Tribunal, which is a people's tribunal on war crimes in Gaza, and spoke to my friend Iran Efrati, who is a former Israeli combat soldier who participated in the attack on Gaza in 2008-2009. And I pointed to him a line which was labeled in Hebrew, Hardufim, and he said Hardufim means dead people. And it's what is traditionally called out on Israeli military radios when there's an Israeli casualty. So that could be for evacuating casualties, but it's also what we were given, the command we were given in 2008-2009 when a free fire zone was created and we could open fire on civilians. Iran had actually interviewed three soldiers who participated in the Battle of Shejaiya and who had direct knowledge of the killing of Salem Shamali, and they said that a red line was established, and they were told that if anyone crosses this line, shoot them. Salem Shamali had crossed that line, and his home fit neatly into the area beyond the Hardufim line. This is what the Israeli human rights group B'Tselem called an open fire policy. So these killings were no accident. These were war crimes that deserved to be punished. punished. And they happened across the Gaza Strip in Hosea, which is a farming village, again, in the buffers, on the border with Israel. You know, they live in a very tough neighborhood in Gaza because they're next to Israel. I met survivors of 9 days of pure hell. I felt like I wandered into a window in hell in this farming village where the Ibad al-Rahman Mosque had been detonated by Israeli soldiers with C4, who declared that they were getting revenge for their dead comrades, where the main water tower had been destroyed, where almost every single house was either badly damaged or completely destroyed, and where people were walking around like ghosts, still in trauma during the war. It was there that I walked into the home of Hani al-Najjar, who was a nurse in the nearby city of Khan Yunis. He took me into his bathroom and was attempting to explain to me why he wanted to destroy his own home, which was still intact. In his bathroom, I found walls caked with human flesh, hair, and blood, and on the floor I saw grenade pins and bullets. 6 men had been bound and executed in his bathroom, and 1 in his child's room. Many of his family members were currently being held in Israeli prisons. They had been taken for interrogations, which often lead to torture. Just around the street, I met the Rujela family, who had lived, all except for 1. They told me about their daughter, Khadir Rujela, 19-year-old, severely disabled girl who could only move in a wheelchair. They attempted to escape from the town, which was surrounded by an Israeli tank division. And when the Israelis began firing on them, they fled and realized they had left their daughter, Khadir. She was found feet in front of her wheelchair about a week later, badly decomposed. The International Committee of the Red Cross was unable to retrieve her at any point or even enter the town. And in many ways, they were unwilling to attempt to do so, and they may deserve to be exposed as well. I later met 2 paramedics from the International Red Crescent, Ahmed Awad and Alaa Al-Kusofi, who had gone into Hosea during the time that it was under siege by the Israeli military, who did so out of conviction as Palestinians in Gaza, but also because they were asked to retrieve a man who had been lashed to a tree by Israeli soldiers and was apparently bleeding to death. He had been shot in his leg. They arrived. The Israeli soldiers told their colleague, Mohammed Abadla, to get out of the ambulance. They told him to walk a few steps forward, hold up a lighter over his head, and then they shot him in the chest. And so these 2 men described to me watching their colleague executed in front of them. I couldn't believe it. But recently I spoke at Princeton University and heard about this from someone in the audience. And I said, "What is your name?" He said, my family is Abadla." I keep having this story confirmed time and time again. Another story of a crime that's going unpunished. In Hosea, I found Stars of David spray painted on the walls of a school for women that was funded by USAID. And in the principal's office, I found weapons. I found weapons being stored in the principal's office. These were weapons produced by Nammo Arms, a Norwegian-owned arms company, which produces them out of Phoenix, Arizona. They are anti-tank, light anti-tank weapons, which were used by the Israeli military against civilian targets in Hosea. So these were the weapons I found being stored in civilian areas, along with the abuse of the symbol of the Jewish religion projected to the people of the Gaza Strip as a symbol of hate, as a symbol of death, as a symbol of everything that's the opposite of what I know it as. And I saw it again and again and again in destroyed homes and schools. In Beit Hanun, another area on the border of Israel to the north, which was destroyed without reason, after most of its residents, if not all, evacuated. I met Abu Rahman, who is the neighbor of the Wahadan family, and he told me how this family had been held in their home on July 17th. While the rest of the village fled, the Israeli soldiers sorted them out. They divided them between the men who were of military age, took them in armored personnel carriers to Israeli prisons for interrogation and possible torture, and kept everyone from two-year-old Rena to her grandparents in the house. A week later, when it appeared that a ceasefire was underway, the Israeli soldiers ordered them to remain in the house, then called in artillery strikes on the entire neighborhood, and within 1 hour, the entire neighborhood was destroyed. There's video of it. As I spoke to Abu Rahman, young men were in the rubble of the Wahadan family home looking for the remaining body parts of two-year-old Hina and her aunt, 52-year-old Baghdad. The rest of the family had been found, parts of them at least. And as Abu Rahman told me how Israeli soldiers and the Israeli military had destroyed his olive trees, they'd destroyed his home, his apiary, his business, and destroyed his neighbor's home, a man approached me with a bunch of grapes and a bottle of cold water. The character of the people I met in the Gaza Strip was impeccable. And if I ever faced any threat as a Jewish journalist, it was from eating too much sugar, the threat of tooth decay, as people handed me candy and sweets everywhere I went in the rubble, in the destroyed homes that they used to live in. The United States, the Obama administration, at every step of the way obstructed diplomacy. We have to remember that at the onset of the war, the conditions that Hamas offered for a 10-year truce with Israel were entirely humanitarian in nature. They wanted a seaport. They wanted to be able to rebuild the airport that had been destroyed. They wanted permits for people to be able to go pray at Al-Aqsa during Ramadan. They wanted a basic standard of living that we all take for granted. That's what they went to war for, and John Kerry rejected all of these terms, aligning himself with the military junta in Egypt, which rose to power through a coup and a sham election, which is currently holding some 40,000 people in prison. Aligning himself with them, the Palestinian Authority, and the Israelis to hold Gaza in a vice, this extended the war to 51 days. And right after the assault on Shujaiya, Barack Obama and the Obama administration authorized Israel to dip into an emergency surplus of weapons that the Pentagon keeps in Israel to allow it to replenish its supplies of mortars and howitzer rounds. What were they going to do with that except destroy more civilian homes? On August 1st, during what appeared to be the beginning of a humanitarian ceasefire, John Kerry oversaw a deal that Hamas didn't participate in. So they were unaware that Israel thought that it was able to continue operating in the Gaza Strip while a humanitarian ceasefire was taking place. A unit from the Israeli Army's Givati Brigade entered the eastern region of the southern town of Rafah in the Gaza Strip and took over a home. They were attacked by a unit from the Al-Qassam Brigades with RPG rounds and light weapons. This unit emerged from a tunnel. Two soldiers were killed, and one, Hadar Golden, who happens to be the second cousin once removed of the Israeli defense minister, one of the golden sons of Israel, was taken through the tunnel shaft. The Al-Qassam Brigade's goal was to kidnap soldiers in order to spur prisoner swaps. They take him. Barack Obama appears on national TV and blames Hamas for breaking the ceasefire, when in fact Israel was operating militarily still inside the Gaza Strip in an offensive capacity, giving Israel all of the political space it needed to invoke the Hannibal Directive. What is the Hannibal Directive? It's a chilling name for a military doctrine. It's a semi-secret military doctrine adopted in 1986 by the Israeli military after the Jibril Agreement, in which Israel released over 1,000 Palestinian prisoners to get two of its own back, I think. It was the point of the Hannibal Directive is to prevent prisoner swaps by allowing the Israeli military to attack kidnapping teams and to kill any Israeli who might be kidnapped in places like the Gaza Strip. So it's a doctrine that allows the Israeli army to kill Israelis, when of course the parents of those soldiers or those Israelis would want them alive. They would want the prisoner swap as Gilad Shalit's parents did. When the Hannibal Directive was enacted in Rafah, it led to the destruction of entire neighborhoods. I visited this area and found shards of MK-82 dumb bombs, shards of drone missiles, artillery and broken pieces of mortars were simply in the street. You couldn't walk down the street without noticing them. Over 100 people were killed, maybe over 120, when the Givati Brigade enacted the Hannibal Directive. It was used not just to attack the ambush team, but as a mechanism for revenge against the entire area of eastern Rafah. Families like the Kadan family, which I interviewed, fled to what seemed like the only safe place, the Al-Najjar Hospital, which was the only functioning hospital in Rafah at the time. As soon as they arrived, the Israeli military phoned in their intention to bomb the hospital. And so all of the dead, the wounded, the doctors, the medical staff came pouring out of the hospital. And the dead and the wounded had to be transferred to a tiny dental clinic in the center of Rafah called Al-Kuwaiti Hospital, which was run by a single doctor who I interviewed, Samir Holmes, who was used to tending to older women. It was a gynecological and dental clinic, or giving kids their dental checkup. He found himself performing emergency amputations on bodies on the floors, in dental chairs. He found one of his nurses, come in a body bag with her body separated from itself, and he had to revive his staff when they fainted after seeing one of their colleagues bisected in such a way. The carnage became so bad that Holmes had to call local shops and bring in ice cream coolers in order to store the bodies of infants. This was, I think, the image of the war, a group of five or six infants in death shrouds stored in an ice cream cooler. They should have been eating ice cream. Ofer Winter was the commander of the Givati Brigade that oversaw the Hannibal Directive. Ofer Winter is one of the most popular figures in Israeli society, and he exemplifies the new breed of religious nationalist soldiers who are moving into the Israeli officer corps and are taking over Israeli society at every level, from the intelligence services to the Knesset to the Israeli government. Ofer Winter believed, and he told in an August 15th interview with Yediot Aharonot, the Israeli newspaper, he said that we were protected by clouds of divine honor when we were attacking Rafah. And then he boasted, we shredded them. He declared, in almost every home, there is a son or other relative that is a partner in terror. And so he admitted that he drew no distinction between civilians and military personnel. Ofer Winter was expressing the sensibility that was also expressed at the time by Knesset member Ayelet Shaked, who said that Palestinian mothers had to be killed before they gave birth to, in her words, little snakes. The mentality of Naftali Bennett, then the economics minister, who declared that the people of Gaza were committing self-genocide. In the current government, Ayelet Shaked is the Minister of Justice, and Naftali Bennett is the Education Minister in charge of designing educational curricula for students. What kind of mentality will they breed, these young, popular, religious nationalist leaders? By August 14th, after the Israeli military pulled out of Gaza, by its own estimate, it had fired 3 million bullets, which is about almost two for everyone living in the Gaza Strip. Over 3,000 tons of ammunition were deployed in this tiny area, which is one of the three most densely populated areas on Earth. 25,000 tank shells were fired into the Gaza Strip. 18,000 homes had been destroyed. Over 400 businesses and factories had been destroyed. At this point, over 100,000 people were homeless, and scabies was spreading through UN shelters. Hamza Abu Murad, the chief of the Gaza Strip's bomb disposal team, who would himself be killed while attempting to dismantle a missile, estimated that actually 18,000 tons of explosives were used against the Gaza Strip, which is 5,000 more tons than were contained in one of the bombs the United States dropped on Hiroshima in World War II. 89 families were wiped from the civil record in the Gaza Strip. 89 families. An Associated Press investigation found that of the 2,200 people who were killed, nearly 900 were killed at home, at night, in their own homes, by precision-guided Israeli weapons. That's 89% of them were civilians. So if you think about the 800,000 or so olive trees which have been uprooted by the Israeli military since 1967, think of the family trees that were uprooted in this attack on the Gaza Strip last summer. Think about that. Think about what kind of crime that is. I want to take you to the end of the war. The war transformed into a kind of air war with the Israeli Air Force, its Hermes 450 and Hermes 900 weaponized drones bombarding the Gaza Strip every night. And you know, to withstand those bombardments for me for just a few nights was nearly impossible. No matter how much Ambien I took, I couldn't sleep. It was just simply terrifying to hear the jarring sound of explosives crashing into a house and wonder who had died. I was sitting at a cafe interviewing the camp breakers, who are the first crew of breakdancers in the Gaza Strip, and they were telling me how they brought breakdancing to Gaza. I hear a massive airstrike nearby, not directly nearby, but in an adjacent neighborhood. It was in the Sheikh Radwan neighborhood. And then another bomb, and then another bomb. And that night I find out that Israel had targeted Mohammed Deif once again, the leader of the Al-Qassam Brigades, with GBU bunker buster bombs, which were given to Israel, ostensibly to attack Iranian nuclear facilities or heavily fortified areas, but instead to attack the home of the military leader of Hamas, who survived. Again, this was an embarrassment to Netanyahu that Deif had survived. Abu Obeidah, Al-Qassam's spokesman, appears on TV to mock Netanyahu, and so he targets the three of the most popular figures within Hamas's military wing, Raed Attar, Mohammed Abu Shamaleh, and Mohammed Barhum and Rafah, and succeeds. How did the Israeli military know that Deif would be in this home? Deif is not his real name. Deif in Arabic, I think, means guest. And he's called guest because he's always a guest in someone's home. He's like, you know, the ultimate couch surfer because he's always on the run for his life. All of these guys are underground. How did they know? It's because every neighborhood in the Gaza Strip is honeycombed with collaborators or informants for the Israeli military. Why are they informing the Israeli military? Why are they committing an act of treason, which we consider treason to be something that's so rare? Because they're desperate. And because they're constantly preyed upon by Unit 8200, which is Israel's version of the NSA. It is actually the largest unit within the Israeli military. It consists of the best and brightest of Israeli society, its most educated members. And their job, or one of their jobs, is to find collaborators by listening to cell phone calls, identifying who's weak, identifying those who need medical treatment, identifying those who are having an affair, identifying those who are homosexual. Listen to the words of one of the refusers from 8200 who protested the war crimes that he had participated in after the war and was summarily punished by his government. If you're homosexual and know someone who knows a wanted person, Israel will make your life miserable. If you need emergency medical treatment in Israel, the West Bank, or abroad, we searched for you. If you interest 8200 and don't have anything to do with any hostile activity, you're still an objective. So tell that to Mayor Ed Murray the next time he goes on a pink washing tour. The Israeli military targets homosexuals and destroys their lives. And these people who are induced into collaborating against their neighbors, some of them were caught. And after these assassinations, some of those who were caught or accused were brought into a public yard in Gaza, in the Gaza Strip, and executed, a scene that Benjamin Netanyahu has used to conflate Hamas with ISIS. But we need to understand the background of this ghastly display and the tragedy behind it, the tragedy that lurks in almost every home in the Gaza Strip, and the paranoia that consumes Gazan society. The war ended with Israel deliberately targeting a series of civilian residential towers and a shopping mall with airstrikes, first bringing down Zafar 4, which is a residential tower in the center of Gaza City that's home to the elite of Gaza, the middle class, the engineers, the doctors, the athletes, those who have nothing to do with the conflict. That was why it was targeted. And so some 40 families were left homeless after being evacuated and watching their building and their lives destroyed by Israeli F-16s. Later, a few hours later, the Italian compound, another large residential tower built by an Italian businessman in the 1960s for Gaza's middle class, its professional class, was brought down by Israeli F-16s, and over 50 families saw their livelihoods, their homes, their memories eradicated. The Basha Tower, which is home to all of the media offices of the Gaza Strip, including the office that Bloomberg News uses when it works in the Gaza Strip, was brought down in the same fashion by Israeli F-16s. It's as if the CNN tower in Atlanta were brought down, or the Thomson Reuters building in New York were brought down. It's as if a media outlet in Paris were attacked by terrorists for no reason at all. But unlike that attack, no one said, "Je suis Gaza." In fact, they listened to Netanyahu, our government, when he said that he was attacking terror towers. In fact, he was enacting the Dahiya doctrine of attacking civilians to turn them against their government, attacking the soft heart of Gaza that had never faced this attack before. And these were where many of my friends lived. I mean, I can't describe to you the kind of terror and the trauma that they experienced, wondering if they would be next. And so the U.S. watched as its, what Barack Obama called its unshakable ally, brought one civilian tower after another down. We should have solidarity with those who lose their towers. But I guess some people don't fit into our frame. With the war over and a ceasefire that guaranteed nothing to the Gaza Strip and which left the status quo in place, the civilian population in the Gaza Strip was left to wonder whether it was worth it, while the Israeli public turned further to the right wing as figures like Naftali Bennett promised that in the next war, he would lead Israeli troops into the heart of Gaza City and would overthrow Hamas and reinstitute a direct occupation. And my book ends, and this talk is gonna end here, with a portrait of a teacher who's a friend of mine named Rifat Al-Arir. I spoke at Bellingham last year, and Rifat spoke there. He actually managed to get a permit for once, a week after me. When I spoke there at Western Washington University, the students, a lot of them had never heard about Israel-Palestine before, especially presented in this way, and they approached me with curiosity, including a young Jewish student who was asking me, just bombarding me with questions. When Rifat spoke a week later, along with two other writers from the Gaza Strip, that Jewish student who is just starting to unpack this for the first time cried openly throughout the entire talk, and now I've been told he's a leader in the burgeoning Palestine Solidarity Movement on that campus. Rifat had told me that he had never spent time with Jews before he was able to travel across the U.S., and that he came to a point earlier in his life as a literature professor at Islamic University, which was founded in 1976 by Sheikh Ahmed Yassin, the spiritual leader and founder of Hamas, that he had his Malcolm X moment, like Malcolm X, who in prison was asked by a member of the Nation of Islam, think about all of the white people you've ever met in your life. How many of them have you had positive experiences with? And Malcolm X, then Malcolm Little, thought, well, all of them have abused me or harmed me in one way or another. And Rifat had had that experience with Jews, that he had never met a Jew who had done anything to him but harm. That is the experience of so many young people in the Gaza Strip growing up under siege who don't even meet Israelis unless those Israelis come to them as faceless killers, either in drones or tanks or pointing guns at them. Rifat was already finding his way out of what many Americans would consider to be an anti-Semitic mentality when he came to the U.S., but it was his ability to live with Jews and to meet them here, to meet people like those who hosted his tour from Jewish Voice for Peace, that he was able to formulate a clear narrative and distance anti-Zionism, and distance Judaism from Zionism. When he returned to the Gaza Strip, he attempted to inculcate his students in this mentality, to help them understand that there was a life beyond this binary, this polarized world that they've been trapped in. He started to teach them about the poetry of the Hebrew poet and writer Yehuda Amichai, who's an Israeli, and he began teaching them The Merchant of Venice, about a Jew placed into impossible conditions by an apartheid-like regime. And at the end of his class, he asked his students, who do you identify with more, Othello, the Venetian general of Arab origin, or Shylock, the Jew? And each one of them, every single one of them, declared that they identified with Shylock. He said it was his proudest day as a teacher. Unfortunately, those papers that his students turned in on The Merchant of Venice were burned when the Israeli military bombed Islamic University and bombed Rifat's office on August 2nd. And his students joked that they were guilty of producing PMDs, or poems of mass destruction. I'll read you an excerpt from one of those students' papers in which she paraphrased Shylock's famous cri de coeur, his famous soliloquy. Hath not a Palestinian eyes? Hath not a Palestinian hands, organs, dimensions, senses, affections, passions? Fed with the same food, hurt with the same weapons, subject to the same diseases, healed by the same means, warmed and cooled by the same winter and summer as a Christian or Jew is? If you prick us, do we not bleed? If you tickle us, do we not laugh? If you poison us, do we not die? And if you wrong us, shall we not revenge? Like the medieval European ghetto masters, our government has decided that the lives of this racial outclass warehoused in Gaza do not matter, that they have not eyes, organs, hands, and that they do not bleed as we do. Otherwise, the policy would not be to resupply the state that's destroying them, occupying them, and besieging them. Otherwise, there would not be an initiative in Congress to increase Israel's annual aid from $3 billion a year to $4.5 billion a year. Otherwise, at least one home out of the 18,000 that were destroyed would have been rebuilt. But a year later, Gaza still lies in ruins. This isn't a complicated situation. Don't let anyone complicate it for you. It's not about good and evil. There's good and evil on both sides. It's about justice versus injustice. It's about basic fairness. It's about basic human decency. That's all this is about. And so it's not enough for me as a journalist to bear witness. It's not enough for me to simply tell you the facts on the ground. It's not enough for you to simply buy this book. And it's not enough to give Gaza your charity. I'll end with the words of Raed Bakr, who is the captain of a fishing boat in Gaza, and his answer to my question, what can we Americans do? Our message is simple, he said. We don't need any aid or anything. Just put pressure on the Israelis so they get out of the sea and let us fish and bring a livelihood to our families again. Thanks.
We have about 20 minutes for Q&A. I'd like to remind folks to come up to the mics on either side of the stage so that we can all hear you. And as Edward mentioned at the beginning, if you could please keep your questions brief and in the form of a question. Thank you.
Max, we depend on you now for knowing what the situation is and how it's changing. How would you contrast what you reported in Goliath with the situation in Gaza and in the West Bank as it exists now?
Thanks. I think the situation is even worse than it was when I finished writing Goliath. But Goliath explains the political and psychological foundation of this war, which brought to bear the full malevolent fury of Israel and its violent capacity against the civilian population in Gaza. And my book explains how that was possible and how a population like Jewish Israeli society could support the war at a level of 95% at its height, with over 45% declaring that the Israeli army had not used enough force. Goliath is a portrait of an active settler colonial society entering into a terminal phase, in which it's unable to vanquish the indigenous population or obliterate it through genocide as the United States did. And it's simply acting out in frustration without any clear solution or strategy. Meanwhile, you have young people, Jewish Israeli youth, who are being heavily indoctrinated into the most comprehensively militarized society on earth. They're told the whole world is against them. They're told the second Holocaust could happen at any time. And they're told that the base of evil is in the Gaza Strip, and that they embody the spirit of Hitler. And I'm not exaggerating. Netanyahu told the entire faculty and all the classes at Bar-Ilan University in October 2013 that the Palestinian National Movement embodies the spirit of the Third Reich. And that's his language. And so you're growing up learning that. You're being sent into the military at age 18, and you have to interact with Palestinians on this basis, where the only way you can interact with them is as an occupier. What does that do to your mentality? What kind of society is that producing? It produces a society that's capable of doing what it did in Gaza. And I think I've said it a million times, but I'll say it again, because I think there's victims on both sides. Zionism is a prison for Palestinian bodies and Jewish minds. And these are the Jewish minds who need to be liberated. And JVP is on, I think, a rescue mission for these Jewish minds. So I'm proud to be involved in this event with them.
So as the part of the American voting public, how can we use the electoral process to have more voice with our presidential candidates? I mean, it seems like now is the time to speak up to the candidates that will be willing to listen. What can you say to us about that?
You can't. There is absolutely nothing you can do to affect the political class in Washington, to affect Congress, at this point, unless you are a billionaire. But there is a lot you can do to effect change, including at a local level. And there are already there are people here who can tell you exactly what to do. I don't think that you should focus your energy the way that you would on another issue like climate change or gay rights or civil liberties. There's no one in Washington who will listen to you and make a public statement or take a public stand at this point. Just look at the most progressive candidate who's running for president, Bernie Sanders. He was a vocal backer of the assault on the Gaza Strip, someone who delivered a tirade against his critics in public. And I know he's kind of clammed up about it, and that's because of the amount of pressure he's getting from people who are organizing at a local grassroots level. So I think there are ways to affect things at the top, but it has to start at the grassroots level, and it starts through the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, which Netanyahu, yes, you can clap. That's what Captain Riad Bakr is asking you to do when he says, put pressure on the Israelis so we can fish again and feed our families. He's asking you to participate in the BDS movement. And so there are people here who can tell you what to do locally, how to get involved. I mean, the Olympia Co-op was a seminal action, and the Israeli government has been directly involved in a slap suit to prevent the lawsuit to prevent the vote, the democratic vote of the Olympia Co-op from taking place. They're actually trying to stop democracy in our communities. So the more democracy, the better. Two more points about that. I really enjoyed the spectacle at the 2012 Democratic Convention when there was a voice vote on whether to declare within the Democratic Party platform that Jerusalem is the undivided capital of Israel, which means, you know, there's no occupation in East Jerusalem. And the nays had it by 2-1. I mean, there was a sound analysis that proved that the nays had it, but Antonio Villaraigosa, who is the mayor of Los Angeles and the DNC chair, who is completely bought off by the pro-Israel lobby, by the Jewish federations. I mean, this is a mayor who goes out and declares his support for Israel's wars as if it pertains to LA. He banged the gavel and said the yeas have it, and that was a visible display of the lack of democracy within the Democratic Party on this issue. I think we have to bring that crisis deeper into the Democratic Party, because if you look at Pew polls of Democrats, those of us who believe in equality for Palestinians, there's a lot of sympathy within the Democratic Party's rank and file. In fact, the last Pew poll I saw showed that most Democrats do not favor Israel over Palestinians. And the more educated they are, the more sympathetic they are to Palestinians. So, and then you look at the Republican Party, I mean, who knows, where was Jeb Bush's first campaign stop? Auschwitz. His first campaign stop was to Auschwitz. It's not even in the United States. He's appealing to Sheldon Adelson, who dominates the Republican Party right now with his money and with his influence, and also happens to be such an influence on Benjamin Netanyahu that he's dictating energy policy within Israel. So the Republican primary is going to bring this issue so far into the public in such an ugly way, with such Islamophobia and anti-Palestinian tirades during the debates, because they're all competing for the money of these figures who, I mean, Sheldon Adelson has called for the U.S. to drop a nuclear bomb on Iran. So that's who they're appealing to. So I think there's an enormous amount of momentum right now with Israel having elected the most right-wing government in its history, and this issue becoming a partisan wedge issue. I mean, the gay marriage issue, the same-sex marriage issue is off the table. That's what Bush used as the partisan wedge issue in 2004. This is the partisan wedge issue, so let's drive the wedge. But it starts here. You have to organize through BDS and with groups like JVP and others.
Yes, I would like to ask you about the Jewish intellectuals who I think are liberals, they like to help the environment, human rights, and all these good issues that they stand for. But when it comes to the Israeli-Palestinian issues, for the Zionism. They all support, not all, sorry, they most of them support the Israelis. What gives? Why is that?
Well, I call it, I mean, I don't want to generalize, but I call it the PEP mentality. I'm sure many of you know this term. Progressive except for Palestine. And I think that's dominant among a particular generation of Jewish liberal intellectuals. I mean, the kind of people who staffed the New Republic and, you know, there was a guy at The Nation who wrote like 9 or 10 attacks on me. I forget his name, some loser. I can't hear you, sorry. But this is an issue of identity politics. I mean, before 1967, I don't think Jewish Americans were deeply engaged in the issue of Israel the way they were. 1967 was a seminal moment. It was a moment of pride for Jews. It was a moment of, you know, muscular Judaism and this miracle victory. Of course, the real narrative of the war wasn't understood. And the baby boomer generation of Jews who were involved in the new left saw, you know, African Americans developing a black nationalist mentality. They saw the brown berets, Chicano nationalism. They wanted a nationalism of their own that would sit comfortably with their aspirations to assimilate into American society, and so Zionism was there for them. I think Zionism is the ultimate form of everything that's wrong with identity politics, because behind it, it's the ideological basis for something that is very real, that many Jews are uncomfortable with engaging. The reality of Israel that I describe in Goliath, or the reality of the Gaza Strip that it's created. So I think it's a generational issue, and if you consider that Jewish Voices for Peace is the fastest growing Jewish organization in America, that's because my generation and those, you know, younger than me are not willing to be inconsistent about their liberalism or their humanism or their progressivism. They can't do it anymore. They grew up on Netanyahu and they see through his Hasbara. So I think things are changing. The issue is how do you provide young Jews with a way to be Jewish and secular without Zionism? Because it's so damn easy. All you need to do is wave an Israeli flag and you have an easy symbol to revolve your identity around. You go on the Birthright Israel tour, I went on that. That's the question. And it's why I joined up with a group called Judas, J-E-W-D-A-S, which is a British socialist anarchist group of Jews who are very into Yiddishkeit, Yiddish culture, and the Levantine Bridge, exploring Jewish Arab culture and anti-Zionism. And we went on a trip to explore the Jewish diaspora, to explore Jewish life before Zionism, and hopefully build a Jewish life after Zionism, which is a completely failed project. So we were in southern Spain just this May. And I think it was, you know, a productive trip. We called it the Birth Wrong Tour. And I want you all in your own communities, whether you're Jewish or not, to organize Birth Wrong Tours and explore the rich, real history of Judaism outside of the hermetically sealed dystopia that Zionism has created.
Could you remind us about that statement, video, book perhaps, produced by the 6 former Jewish defense ministers that...
Oh, you're talking about the gatekeepers.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was... I had a lot of issues with this film. I mean, these are figures in the Israeli military intelligence apparatus who see what the occupation has done to Israeli society, who are aligned with the Labor Party, and who don't really care that much about the welfare of Palestinians. They just see that the occupation, if it persists, will lead to the BDS movement and what they call delegitimization, and it will, you know, cause it, and it will also reinforce the power of the right wing, who are their political rivals. And so what they want is actually a softer occupation, or maybe a 1.5 state solution, what they've always wanted with the Oslo Accords, which is to hand over control of a few Bantustans in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip to U.S.-trained security forces, which are already operating under Mahmoud Abbas's control, and, you know, to keep Palestinians under the control of an occupation subcontractor. something the South African apartheid regime tried and failed to do by creating its own Bantustans. I don't know if you remember, I think it's called Bafuto Tswana. It was the only one that sort of came into being, and there was only one country besides South Africa that would vote to recognize it in the UN, and that was Israel. So it's the same vision, and it's a failed vision, because now you have in power people like Ayelet Shaked, who I mentioned, Deputy Foreign Minister Sipi Hotevelli, Education Minister Naftali Bennett, and Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who have openly declared that they have no interest in even this fake two-state solution. They want a single, unitary, apartheid state. And so all of the warnings of the gatekeepers have not been heeded by the Israeli political class, and they're in an incredible crisis where BDS is taking off. But I just want to avoid seeing these, I want to emphasize these figures are not humanists who care about Palestinians. They're just, they simply want to, they are advocates of a wiser settler colonialism. Yeah.
What you described tonight, if you look at the firepower on each side, is an overwhelming massacre of the, you know, of the people that had the big firepower. And by the way, you said Israeli F-16s.
Yeah.
Those are American F-16s. For the last 30 years, it's been the greatest fighter plane in the world, an American. Predator drones, probably American Hellfire missiles, paid for by American taxpayers. So why aren't we morally equally to blame for this atrocity that you described? And is the reason that we're not, because we here tonight are hearing you with an excellent presentation, but is this going to be on CNN tomorrow?
No.
Is it going to be on Morning Joe? Is it, I'll bet not.
I remember the last time I was on that show.
So few people that control our networks. It's like Edward Bernays and his book Propaganda. Our worldview is, you know, presented to us, and so we just accept it. It's always a retaliation. A retaliation. Was this a retaliation?
I think you answered your own question, which is, are we morally to blame? And you know, I'm all for, you know, liberal guilt and like shaming people. But we don't have a democratic media. We don't have a democratic party or Republican party. Just look at the Trans-Pacific Partnership. You think Americans want that? You think they had any say in that? So are we morally responsible for the fact that we are now going to help companies that run that use slaves in Malaysia? They use slaves. I mean, this has been widely reported by, and Barack Obama knows about it, but he still went ahead with this to give himself more executive authority and to please his donors. It's the same thing on Israel-Palestine. But we have so whether or not we're morally responsible, we have an obligation as Americans. If it wasn't for Israel's direct line to Washington, the occupation, the siege, the whole project would unravel tomorrow. I mean, that's the position that we're in. And so it's an obligation, and it starts here with very simple BDS actions that could take place at your local supermarket. You have to start somewhere. And it's working. It's working. I mean, there's enormous panic within the Israeli government right now that I've never seen, and I've been following the BDS movement since like 2009. They've created a special ministry within the Israeli government to fight BDS. I mean, they're not gonna do that unless you're accomplishing something. My friend Danny Schechter, some of you might know of him, he died in March, and the memorial for him was, you know, heavily attended 2 days ago. My family was there. He knew me when I was like this big. Danny Schechter, the news dissector, he helped give birth to independent media when he was doing radio at WBCN in Boston. And he was one of the first alternative reporters. Like, he made it possible for me to do what I'm doing. His funeral opened with the singing of the South African national anthem, the ANC anthem. And it was welcomed by figures from the South African embassy or consulate in New York, because Danny played a huge role in spurring the BDS movement against the apartheid regime of South Africa through his movement to not play Sun City. Sun City was a South African resort in Bafuta Tswana, the Bantustan, and he organized artists to declare, I ain't gonna play Sun City. It's important for those of you who are involved in culture and arts to organize people to not play Tel Aviv, which is the new Sun City, to prevent people, to shame people like your mayor who go on pinkwashing tours. There's so much you can do to bring this issue to the American public and to create pressure. And a recent victory was preventing Lauryn Hill from playing in Tel Aviv. But there are smaller victories every day. So there you go. That's our obligation as Americans.
Let me ask.
Yeah. Well, let's take them all at once.
Going back to the 67 war, Israel captured the Sinai in Gaza and made peace with Sadat, and it's been fine. And then Ariel Sharon, who is a hawkish general that Israel's had, withdrew out of Gaza with the idea of peace. And what happened? Gaza immediately became a rocket launching site into Israel, with Hamas dedicated to the destruction of Israel. What you didn't talk about today was, what was Israel's response supposed to be to thousands of rockets coming in indiscriminately, and how are they supposed to react? If it's in a residential area, you let the rockets fly? You can't do that. So what do you think Israel's response should have been to the rockets coming in from Gaza?
In 1971, the Israeli government rejected an offer by Nasser, which was actually proffered to him by through the World Zionist Organization. For negotiations over the Sinai. This is an established fact. There's an established fact that Israel, under, I think it was Golda Meir, rejected a chance to negotiate with Gamal Abdel Nasser over the Sinai Peninsula, which led to the 1973 war. The only way Egypt could retake that territory was through the Great Crossing, when they went in with, and many Israelis died as a result. So Israeli political leadership has never wanted to negotiate. Moshe Dayan said, what was it Moshe Dayan said? I'd rather, say it louder. I'd rather have Sharm el-Sheikh without peace than peace with Sharm el-Sheikh. That is the defining mentality of Israel's political leadership going forward. And so Avigdor Lieberman, after this war, who is the outgoing foreign minister, declared that a third war in southern Lebanon is inevitable, just as a fourth war with the Gaza Strip is inevitable. This is a society and a political leadership that is incapable of dealing with any problem without force. And so the solution isn't, you know, what do they do? Oh, apparently your solution is to continue carpet bombing Gaza. It doesn't seem like you're offering any other solution. I'm offering a solution. I don't know if you'll accept it or not as an American, someone with liberal, humanitarian values. My solution is democracy. How about giving Palestinians a right to have rights? Let's take it from there.
Don't argue with him.
We voted for George W. Bush here. Should we be sanctioned? Actually, we didn't even vote for him. The Supreme Court voted for him. Two more last questions.
So Obama unconditionally supported Israel last year in its attack on Gaza, and yet now, you know, we have the appearance of a deep split between Obama and Netanyahu on Iran.
Sorry
what are
to
your
interrupt
thoughts
you,
on that?
Sorry to interrupt you. The person who offered the peace, who was negotiating between Sadat and Israel, was Nahum Goldman. He's still alive. His son is still alive, Guido Goldman in New York, if you want to talk to him about that. Anyway, sorry to interrupt.
Yes, I'd like your thoughts on the current split between Obama and Netanyahu on Iran, and what do you think will be the outcome?
The deal is extremely popular in the U.S., having a deal. And the deal is popular among Jews, according to every poll I've seen. And it's part of the legacy Obama wants to leave. But I haven't been following it that closely. Every time it seems like they're gonna ink the deal, something new happens. I mean, there are figures within the Iranian government who've been central to the deal. One of them is undergoing surgery. You know, the Ayatollah keeps shifting back and forth. He's under pressure within Iranian society, and Barack Obama's under enormous pressure from the Israel lobby in Washington, which includes the Democratic Party. So I don't have a clear answer for you, and I haven't been following it closely enough. But it seems like a case where, once again, at every stop, I would just, the point I would make is that every stop when Barack Obama has tried to advance diplomacy with Iran, enacting the will of the American public, he's been slam dunked by Congress. John Kerry even voted for really unhelpful, crushing sanctions against Iran. It was a 100-0 vote in the Senate, and Barack Obama and the White House tried to stop that vote. So it really speaks to the undue influence of the Israel lobby. I thought you were up there before, but if you want, we can do them both, and then I'll condense my answer.
Okay. Yes. Max, as you said, the political support for in the U.S. for Israel is tremendous, and it certainly comes from the very effective Jewish groups, although there's more dissent there now. And can you comment on the comments that Michael Oren has had against some of the liberal journalists?
Well, as you know, many countries, many Western allies of the United States are moving toward the recognition of the Palestinian state, especially within the European Union. I would like to know what impact this is going to have in the conflict and in the United States leadership in foreign policy or in the international community.
The first question is about Michael Oren's new book, which is called Betrayal. Michael Oren is the former ambassador from Israel to the U.S., but Michael Oren was born Michael Bornstein. He is an American Jew who held, I think, dual Israeli-American citizenship and was offered the ambassadorship by his close friend Benjamin Netanyahu. Oren had worked for years in the Shalom Center, which is a Likud-oriented think tank. That's basically Netanyahu's outsourced brain. And when he was offered the ambassadorship, he gave up his American citizenship in order to avoid the appearance of dual loyalty, something Alan Dershowitz couldn't do when he was offered the ambassadorship to the UN by Netanyahu. He somehow likes being an American and sunning himself on the nude beaches of Martha's Vineyard every summer. So Oren comes out with this book. I mean, it's true, although he said he kept his underwear on when Jeffrey Epstein's models were massaging him. But so Oren comes out with this book rehashing the Dolchstoss narrative, which was used in pre-World War II Germany to accuse left-wing, communist, and especially Jewish elements of betraying Germany during World War I. And Oren, who attacks figures from like Thomas Friedman and Leon Wieseltier, who are avowed Zionists, he attacks them as anti-Israel and accuses them of betraying the state of Israel, betraying their Jewish values, and stabbing Israel in the back when they were simply opponents of Netanyahu. Oren paints Netanyahu as kind of like the supreme leader of JSIL, or the Jewish state in Israel and the Levant, and not someone who was elected by less than 30% of the Israeli public, who Jewish Americans really generally don't like very much. And he accuses them of a kind of anti-Semitism in their resentment of Netanyahu. It's a really remarkable book, and it's causing an enormous rift between liberal Zionists and right-wing Likudnik Zionists. It really is the leading edge of the kind of Likudnik narrative about Israel in this, I think, in its natural state, which is as a pariah state after the death of the peace process when liberal Judaism in the U.S. is pulling away. And I think it's really helpful. I want to see more of him out there accusing our leading pundits of anti-Semitism. It's like I felt so alone for a while, but, you know. The EU recognition of the state of Palestine is interesting because it's like me recognizing Santa Claus or a unicorn. There is no state of Palestine, and there may never be. And, you know, I personally don't think that the way to go is to push for Palestinian sovereignty, which requires a kind of forced separation between Palestinians and Jewish Israelis and leaves the refugees to their own misery wherever they are. But France has gotten behind this. An extremely Islamophobic government, by the way, in France is leading the drive for the recognition of the state of Palestine. It's doing so for a number of reasons. One is because France wants to be a leader now that the U.S. has pulled away from the peace process that doesn't exist, and it's reasserting its role in the Middle East as one of the former great colonial powers. Two is to shore up Mahmoud Abbas, who's getting old, and making sure that the Palestinian Authority still has diplomatic support. By the way, there are lots of reports of Israel negotiating beneath the surface with Hamas while it's not negotiating with Abbas. The practical effect is, you know, besides recognizing a two-state solution that will never happen, which is, a dangerous solution, and so I think that's a negative effect. The positive effect is that the recognition of some area in the West Bank as a Palestinian state recognizes that goods produced there in illegal settlements can be labeled in the EU and they can be sanctioned. And so we're seeing the Israeli government, which really intends to annex the West Bank, opposing this tooth and nail. That leads to another, I think, positive effect, which is it's deepened the clash between the Israeli government and its patrons in Europe. Anyway, thanks a lot. You were incredible.
Max Blumenthal, thank you so much. The 51-Day War is available at the U Bookstore.